In this video, we'll see a detailed explanation about the authentication process that takes place using the Spring Boot application. Here, as we have already seen, we have client authentication server and the resource server. The client I'm using over here is Postman, and the authentication server being KeyCloak, and the resource server will be a Spring Boot application which we are going to implement. As we have already seen this, let's represent the same sequence diagram in a different way, something like this. This is the representation of the previous diagram itself, but in a different way. I have changed the naming conventions. Instead of using client, I am using Postman, and authentication server, I am using KeyCloak, and the resource server, it's a Spring Boot application. What Spring Boot application does is it uses Spring Security for the authentication process. Here we are going to see the authentication process first. Later we'll see the authorization process as well. So Spring Security is being used for the authentication process, and within that Spring Security, it uses security filter chain. We'll name it as security filter itself, and if we zoom in a bit more within the security filter in turn uses OAuth2 resource library for the authentication process. Again, if we zoom in a bit more, what OAuth2 resource library does is it uses two ways of authentication. One is a JWT and another is the opaque token. You cannot use both of them together. You have to either use JWT or you have to use opaque token in an application and not both of them at once, else it will give you an error. Let's see JWT in detail here. So whenever you are using JWT for the authentication, the JWT will not send any request to the KeyCloak. Instead, the token which is being received from the Postman or any other requester will be validated within the resource server itself by the JWT, and it will not be sent to the KeyCloak. So this is how it looks, because since it doesn't send the request, I have just removed that communication. Let's see what happens within the JWT. What JWT does is it basically validates two things. First thing what it does is it uses the JWT timestamp validator class to validate the time that is being sent within the token. So within the access token, there will be a property called exp, and the value for this exp is the time in seconds. This JWT timestamp validator uses the current time and cross checks to the value of this property to check whether the access token is expired or it is still valid. If it is not valid, an error message will be returned. And if it is valid, the next validator is called. The next validator here is a JWT issuer validator. This JWT issuer validator uses JWT claim validator. Here what basically happens is there is a property called issuer in the access token, which is spelled with ISS. The value of this issuer will be cross-checked with the issuer, which is defined within the Spring Boot application, and if they match, it is said to be as success, and if they do not match, then claim validator sends an error message saying the issuer is invalid. Let's see this in a bit detail. The JWT timestamp validator, what it does is it gets the current time in seconds and deducts 60 seconds from the current time. In a sense, it is trying to add one extra minute for the access token. Suppose the access token validity is 30 minutes, JWT timestamp validator validates for 31 minutes. In a sense, it is adding an extra minute for the access token. And then it gets the value of the EXP property from the access token, and it checks if the current time minus 60 seconds, the first point which we saw, is less than the expiry value. If it is less, then it means the token is still valid. If it is more than that, or equals to or more than that, it means the token is expired. So it sends an error message. In JWT claim validator, what happens here is it gets the value from the property, whatever the property I have specified, the issuer URI, the value of this property specified in the Spring Boot application is being retrieved, and then it gets the value of the ISS property, which is present in the access token. It checks if both of these property values are equal. If they are equal, then it is set to be as a valid token. If they are not equal, then the token is invalid because of the invalid issuer. That was about the JWT. And if we use opaque token, this is pretty simple. Opaque token doesn't validate within the resource server, but instead it sends the request to the key cloak. So there is no need to worry about how the validation happens, but just route the request to the key cloak. What happens over here is whenever a request comes from the postman or any other requester, opaque token uses the Spring opaque token inspector, and this Spring opaque token inspector makes a REST call to the key cloak server. And how does that happen is it gets the value of this property introspection URI as introspect URI, and another property opaque token client ID in client ID, and the third property for opaque token client secret as client secret. So using these three properties, it makes a REST call using the REST template to the key cloak. Once response is received from the key cloak, based on that response, it decides whether to give the access to the requester or not. These were the two main ways of authentication within the Spring Boot application. Now let's see the application itself and a demonstration of whatever we have discussed over here. Thanks for watching.